Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, you're worthy to receive all glory and all honor this morning. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy. You are worthy. And so we lift you up this morning. We magnify and glorify your name because you are the great I am. You have my life, you have my heart. You have my trust this morning, God, and I place it in your hands this morning. You have my life. You have my heart. You have my trust. Hallelujah, this morning. And I give it all to you. Come on, somebody say, I give it all to you. I give it all to you this morning. I give it all to you. I give it all to you, God. Hallelujah. I give you my life. I give you my heart. I give you my trust. I give it all to you this morning. I give it all to you. I give it all to you. I give it all to you this morning. I give it all to you. I give it all to you this morning. Hallelujah. You alone are worthy. You alone are worthy, Abba Father. You alone are worthy. Welcome one and all this morning to Recharge Ministries. Amen. Welcome, 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 welcome to Recharge Ministries this morning, where we give God all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. We give it all to Him this morning. We give it all to Him this morning. We give Him all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you this morning for yet another day, another Sunday, another week, because this is the beginning of a brand new week, Lord. And Lord, as we come to you, Lord, we recognize and know that you are Lord. Hallelujah. You are King of Kings. Hallelujah. And so this morning, we place you always at the highest place in our lives. And Lord God, we submit ourselves unto you today. I pray, Almighty God, that as you speak, Lord, we will hear your words, and not only hear your words, Lord God, but we will apply your words unto our lives so that we can be better. Hallelujah. We can be changed and we can be transformed and we can be renewed. Because we have dared to have an encounter with you. And so, Lord God, this morning, speak like you have never spoken before. Lord God Almighty. And I pray, Lord God, that when your word fall and it's deposited, Lord God, we will know, hallelujah, that the visitation has been done and our lives will be changed for the better. We give you all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. And we say in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost, amen and amen. Hallelujah. So this morning is it yet another day wherein God is wanting to speak to us. And today, I just want to do a recap over since the year has begun. The Lord said to us, next level. Hallelujah. The Lord then says, God's brand. What is my brand? Then one validator, then choose your battles. And yesterday on another platform, I spoke on God's process. And today, the Lord is saying, you are chosen. You are chosen for his purpose. So don't be a chameleon. Stand out rather than fitting in. You are chosen for God's purpose. So don't be a chameleon. Stand out rather than fitting in. I pray to God this morning that you're going to choose to stand out and not fit in because you are chosen for God's purpose. And why is this so fitting? It's because, you know, we've closed the door on last year. And this is a brand new year. This is the beginning of the year. And so we're doing a lot of reflections. We're doing a lot of house cleaning. So now is the right time to set your course. Where are you going? And the Lord says, you are chosen for his purpose. So don't be a chameleon. Stand out rather than fitting in. So the two scriptures which were already read this morning, it's 1 Peter 2, 9 through 10, and Jeremiah 32, 38 through 39. First Peter 2, 9 through 10 reads as thus from the English English Standard Version. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession. Underscore that. A people for his own possession, that you may reclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Jeremiah 32, 38 through 39. And they shall be my people, and I will be their God. And I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever, for their own good and the good of their children after them. For their own good and the good of their children after them. So I'm going to start with a brief synopsis of a story, because this is real as to where we're going. So perhaps you were good in sports growing up, because I was, believe it or not, I was. Soccer was my, softball was my thing. Or maybe you were a good debater because you were great in academics. And the reason you are selected is because you had something valuable to bring to the group that you chose to participate in. Either you are good in sports or you are good academically, such as a good debater. You were of value to the team that selected you. So you were placed on that team because of the value that you brought to the team. So the reality today is God chooses people to use for his kingdom. And oftentimes, the people he chose or chooses are outcasts, forgotten about, not wanted or leftovers. And this is consistent with how and who God chose in the past, how he chose them in the past, which means no matter where you find yourself today or how you view yourself, God wants you. So no matter where you find yourself today or how you view yourself, God wants you. Yes, you. I'm speaking to you, nobody but you. God wants you. And if you have doubts about God choosing people that we may not choose, just scroll through the Bible and you will discover that God does in fact choose those that we would overlook or shun today. We wouldn't choose them, but God chose them. And God is saying today that he wants you. Despite what you have been through, despite what you look like, he says he wants you. So what does it mean to be chosen? And 1 Peter 2, 9 through 10 says it very clear. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness. So he's pulling you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For you once were not a people, but you now are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So in order to understand the significance of what Peter said, we have to understand the context in which he is writing. When Peter wrote this letter, he does so to a group of Christians who were scattered throughout the northern part of Asia Minor. The Christians were aliens and foreigners in a land they found themselves in. They were not blended in like the chameleons. Like I said, don't be a chameleon, stand out. They were not blended in like the chameleons. that blend into its surroundings to the point where it's hard to distinguish them. Ha, you cannot blend in like a chameleon. Because when you blend into your surroundings, it's hard to distinguish who you are among them. Meaning they did not conform to or look like the world around them as they are chosen. And when you are chosen, you are separated out. You are set apart. You are extraordinary. You're not like everybody them. So therefore, do not conform to or look like the world. Because you are chosen. God wants you because he has chosen to select you. And these Christians, they clearly stood out. And that's exactly how the Lord wanted it. Had they not chased out, had they not been chosen and set apart, they would not have been chased out of Israel. And the good news of the gospel would not have been spread as quickly because they chose not to conform. So they were outcasts. And the good news of the gospel was spread. And only did so because those who were scattered did not fit in with their surroundings. But they stood out. Are you standing out or you're fitting in? So the people of old, they did not conform. So when they were scattered, they stood out. And many of them were facing sufferings because of that, because they chose not to conform. And they chose not to fit in because they were resolute about their stance. Therefore, Peter seeks to encourage them in their faith. Because sometimes it's very hard when you're being cast out. But they knew that they had to remain their stance and they had to remain resolute because of what they believed in. They were chosen. They were selected for such a time as this. And God wants you because you are chosen. And it's time to reflect on where am I on the spectrum? Am I trying to fit in? But you're being a misfit in the process of being fit in, of fitting in. Because when you don't belong, everybody can know it. Believe it or not, they see it. When you don't belong in an environment, people can see it. You're trying to blend in, but people see and know that you are not like them. So don't conform. Don't try to fit in. Don't be a chameleon. Because you are chosen. And in the passage, I believe there are three things in particular that Peter is trying to do. He's trying to remind, challenge, and strengthen. Remind, challenge, and strengthen. And if we receive each of these things for ourselves today, we will understand the significance of God choosing to use us. And we will achieve greater things in our walk with Christ than ever before. Because he's reminding us, he's challenging us, and he's strengthening us in the process. So number one, the key point that I want you to take away is God reminds us of who we are. As you uncover and recognize that you are chosen, God reminds you of who you are. So the first thing we see Peter do in the writing is simply try to remind the believers of who they are. He says in 1 Peter 2:9, you are chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. And the key phrase to sum up all that Peter is trying to remind them of is a final thing, which he says that they are God's very own possession. I want you to ponder and think about this for a few moments. We are God's very own possession. Yes, you. You are God's very own possession. I belong to him. He owns my life. He owns my future. I belong to him. I am his possession, his very own. Not that I'm a part of all of the possessions, but he said I'm his very own possession. Extra additive on that. That God's very own possession. And Jeremiah 32, 38 through 9, 39 affirms and solidifies this statement by saying, and they shall be my people. And I will be their God. And I will give them one heart and one way that they may fear me always for their own good and for the good of their children after them. So generations after us. If we understand who we are, generations after us will reap the benefits of what we have done. This is a promise God makes to his people all the way back in the Old Testament before Jesus even arrived. A promise that still stands in 1 Peter because of the pathway Jesus made for all the people to have access to the Heavenly Father. When God chose us, it did not just mean that we are his people, but it also means that he is our God. I want somebody to understand that this morning, that it just didn't mean that we are his people, and that's where it stopped. It means that he is our God. He will fight for me. Because he's my creator. He's my all in all. He's my source. So no matter what others think of you, God chose you. No matter what others think about you, God chose you. He had selected you. He had picked you.
Hallelujah.
You are chosen for such a time as this. Because many of us are grappling with that. Why God? Why now? When I want to do my own thing, you are intercepting and interrupting what I'm trying to do. God is saying, I chose you. I chose you because you are my people. And because you are my people, I am your God. And because I am your God, governing everything that you do, your life is in my hands. Oh my God. God, that's why this morning, my life, my heart belongs to you. All of me belongs to you because you chose me. I am chosen. So I was one of those who the world was not kind to. And many of you on here can testify to that, that the world was not kind to me. The world has abused me, misused me. Cast me out. And every day I feel beat up. The trials are real. The temptations are real. My God. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Why do I feel like every time I get up, I'm being battered back down to the floor? But although the world may not care about you and I, God says, I love you. My God, that has been one of my synonymous themes that I've had. God says, I love you. I love you. And God said that to all of us continually and consistently. Can't you hear it? I love you. I love you. So the world may reject us, but God looks beyond what the world thinks. And and its reasonings why they that they have disdain towards you, but he looks to our hearts and molds us to his kingdom. He's molding us because he's a potter and we are the clay. So he's molding you to his kingdom this morning. And if we look close enough, throughout the Bible, there seems to be a trend and a pattern. And I wanted to understand that God does things in patterns and trends. So frequently, for God to take us where he wants us to be, he often has to remind us of his faithfulness. He's reminding each of you this morning where you're saying, God, you're going to let me fail? God is saying, no. How many times have I brought you over? How many times have I saved you? So this morning he's reminding you of his faithfulness.
Hallelujah.
I never left you. I will never forsake you. I am always there in the midst thereof. And Peter is doing the same here for the person struggling to grasp this fact. I put this in a little paraphrase way. I know it's tough. Hear God's voice this morning. He's saying, I know it's tough. I know there is suffering and persecution all around you. And you're probably on the brink of giving up. But I need you to remember, I chose you. For that person that's struggling. God says, I know it's tough. I know there is suffering and persecution all around you. And you're on the brink of giving up. But I need you to remember this morning. If you don't remember anything else, remember that I chose you. And not only that I chose you, not so that I could leave you, but so that, my God, I could use you. Because you're usable. That's why I chose you. Remember today that you are mine. And I chose you because I love you. What an awesome reminder. What an awesome declaration of who God is. He said, I chose you. I hand selected you. It was intentional. There's purpose on your life. When I molded you, I knitted you in your mother's womb. I knitted everything inside of you because I chose you. Key point number two, accept the challenge today. So the second thing I believe Peter sets out to do in this passage is that to challenge the scattered Christians. He gives them their mission. And in doing so, it becomes our mission as well. He just finished reminding them God chose them. That's what he did in the beginning stanza. And he goes on to tell them in 1 Peter 2 and 12, live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God. So Peter is saying, don't be a chameleon and conform to your new surroundings, but be ye transformed and stand out for the cause of Jesus Christ. Because we're not saved by our works. We are saved to work for God's glory. We are saved to work for God's glory. And a lot of us tend to receive God's blessing in our lives, convinced that they're only for us. And we think we can keep them to ourselves. We hold them so close to the vest. But Psalm 67 says, may God be gracious to us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us, that your ways may be known on earth, your salvation among all nations. We ask for his blessings, yes, and grace. And we're not to stop there. We ought to make his salvation known to all the earth. That's the challenge that we must accept this morning. And our passage from Peter also speaks about the concept of advancing the kingdom of God. And it's related to living a righteous lifestyle, our conduct, our behavior. And the choice God made to choose us was ultimately to bring glory and honor to his name. And the way we live is so important because the truth is people are always watching. People are always watching. The way we live our lives is one of the loudest testimonies we will ever share with others. Evangelist Lisa, I remember our conversation, and that's where I penned that sentence right there. The way we live our lives is one of the loudest testimonies we will ever share with others. It's the way we live, the way we walk, the way we talk, the way we exercise our faith in God. And yesterday, I was at a funeral, and I heard the pastor at the funeral as she was doing the sermon. And she said, in living our lives, we are writing our eulogy. That I don't think I heard anything else because I got stuck there. She said, in living our lives, we are writing our eulogy. What are you living and saying as it might be included in your eulogy and in a tribute at your funeral? I want that to simmer right there. In living our lives, we are writing our eulogy. So what are you living and saying as it might be included in a tribute and in your eulogy at your funeral? So the way we live our lives is one of the loudest testimonies we will ever share to others. Let it simmer. I want it to simmer with you. I pray to God that when folks go up to do a reflection, the other thing the moderator said is a wife was sitting there and she heard all these glorious things about the man in the casket. And she was like, I have to go run and see who is that in the casket, because that don't sound like him. Let that not be us this morning. Let it not be us. That people don't go up there and create a storyline that wasn't us. But every word that's spoken is exactly the life that we live. What are you doing in your dash? Because the way we live our lives is one of the loudest testimonies we will ever share with others. So accept the challenge this morning. Stand out because you are a chosen people. God selected you. He handpicked you. A theologian says, preach the gospel at all times. And when necessary, use words, meaning our deeds and actions are preaching on our behalf, even when we aren't saying anything. So preach the gospel at all times. And when necessary, use words or use your actions, because our deeds, our works are preaching on our behalf, even when we aren't saying anything. And if that makes you uncomfortable, because it made me uncomfortable, it really did as I was writing, maybe we need to do some self-reflection like we're doing right now. I'm not asking for another ritual, because every year, at the beginning of the year, we do our 21-day fast and Daniel fast and all of that, and we get caught up what we're going to eat and what we're going to do, but nothing changes. The Seer, there needs to be an uncomfortable state that we enter in. And if that makes you uncomfortable about what I just said, then maybe we need to do some self-reflection. Because like I said, in living our lives, we are writing our eulogy. And this is a point well taken from the funeral I went to yesterday. I've been to too many since the year began. Two is too many. So Peter is addressing a group of believers who are watching, who are watched all the time. Why? Because they are different. They are standing out. Someone should look at you and say, man, that person is different. They don't conform. They don't add to the gossip. They're not at the water cooler tearing down. That person is different. They remove themselves. They excuse themselves. They don't add to the gossip news. They don't tear down. But every time I encounter this person, it's words of encouragement. It's words of inspiration. Even if the whole building is tearing down, they said there's possibilities everywhere. They're causing me to be different, to do different, to feel different, to act different. Because people are intrigued by this message. People are intrigued by you and I. And they want to see how you're living, because are you impacting them? But what impact are you creating? Is it negative or positive? So as Peter is admonishing in his writing, he's throwing out a challenge to use this for the kingdom advancement when we stand out and we separate and come out from among them and not be he therefore conformed. But we're transformers. And the same challenge applies to you today. So I wonder, in your daily life, watching the way you live, who is watching the way you live, the way you speak, the way you spend your time, the way you treat others? And as we all know, what are you posting on social media? Because they are interested in what you believe and what you're thinking. So what is your daily life unfolding? What is it telling others? Because people are watching. The hourglass is on you. The monitoring spirits are real. Everyone, someone out there is monitoring you, whether you like it or not. Known and unknown, they're monitoring you. So they're watching the way you live, the way you speak, the way you spend your time, the way you treat others. And what are you posting on social media? So as God's chosen people, when we are called chosen and separated, what are you showing the world that Christ looked like? Because you're walking in his image. You're wearing his brand. So what are you showing the world what Christ looks like? So you gotta stand out. Because when you stand out, you are proclaiming the light that overcomes darkness. You can't overcome darkness with darkness. Darkness can only be dispelled when light is illuminated. when you walk into a dark room. Darkness can't illuminate darkness. You got to turn on the light to dispel the darkness, can't you? It's not so. So you got to stand out and proclaim the light that will overcome the darkness. And this morning, I'm reminded of a song, Humble Yourselves in the Sight of the Lord. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. So are we truly humbled when we consider that God chose us for his work? And I'm blown. Lord, really? Can you use little old me? I'm in awe. He chose me. And if we consider this a task that we are unable to meet, then it's a good thing. Because I don't think I can measure up. I said, God, really? But if we consider this is a task that we're unable to meet, it's a good thing and a good position that we're in. Because you know what? Then this will enable us to rely on God completely to provide. Because every day I said, God, I really can't do this. Every single day. And he provides. He never fails. He provides. Because I submit myself completely in his hands. I've not arrived and will never arrive. I will always be a student in his classroom. And just like the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 12, 9 through 11, it says, for when I am weak, then I am strong. So when the early Christians put their trust in the Lord, they achieved great things for the Lord. And I'm sure that the Lord will do the same for us when we put our trust in God. Because you know what? You are the light of the world. That's what Matthew 5, 14 and 15 says. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill and cannot be hidden. Nor do men light a lamp and put it under the peak measure, but on the lampstick. And it gives light to all who are in the house. So are you a reflection of Christ to those around you? So people see the light of Jesus through you. Because you're chosen. You can't deny it. You are chosen. So step up. Accept the challenge this morning. And the third and final point is be strengthened and be courageous. So the final thing Peter says in this passage as he writes, he encourages the people of God to be an example. He says he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. Once you had no identity as a people, now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, now you have received God's mercy. And one of the most striking biblical examples of God's mercy and grace over a person's life is found in the transformation of Saul, the Pharisee, to Paul, the apostle. Saul was present during the stoning of Stephen. He was hunting Christians from house to house, and God intervened literally as Saul was traveling from one persecution to another. His story in Acts 9, 3 through 5 says, and he neared Damascus on his journey. Suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him, and he fell to the ground and heard a voice and say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? Saul said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting, he replied. So Saul was walking in darkness. And the light of Christ met him in the midst of his journey. You and I were walking in darkness. Some of you are still in darkness, but I'm here to tell you this morning that the light of Christ is going to meet you in the midst of your journey. And God not only had mercy on Paul, but loved the Gentile nations as much as he chose Paul to be their appointed apostle and bearer of the gospel. Saul deserved death, yes, because of what he did. But through Christ, he received life. So here's not what you and I have done. It deserves death. But through Christ, we will receive life. Because we're no different in that regard. God said, yes, it was egregious what you did, what I did. But through Christ, you will receive life. And here's the beauty of Paul. He traded the rest of his earthly life to serve Christ. So this morning, is your life like that of Paul's? Are you giving your life to serve Christ? Or are you just fooling ourselves and trying to fit in? God, whenever we can in our busy lives, there's little extra time. God gets the extra. God gets the what left. Let's level up this year. Let's level up. Because this is the kind of kingdom transformation Paul is encouraging, sorry, Peter is encouraging in his letter. He's challenging believers to remember who and whose we are. He's challenging them to step into their calling and represent Christ to others around them, both in their words and in their deeds, in their works. He's challenging them to not be chameleons, not to blend in with those around them, but to stand out and to stand out for God. Are you standing out for God? Are you standing up for God? The bottom line encouragement this morning is for all of us on this journey called life. God can use any of us. God will use any of us. You are chosen. Your life is not your own. As Rhoda Isabella said, my life belongs to you. I give it all to you. Because God can redeem any life and bring all those lost sheep home. He wants to bring all the lost sheep home. He left the 99 just to pursue that one that was lost. Are you that one this morning that's lost? Confused, rejected, and dejected. He wants to bring all lost sheep home. If God can turn a Saul into a Paul, then just imagine what he can do in and through your life this morning. Say, God, I give it all to you. My life, I give it all to you. My heart, I give it all to you. My trust, I give it all to you, God. God, I'm chosen. You chose me for times such as this. I give it all to you. If you can turn a Saul into a Paul, you can do what you have done for me as well. Embrace me this morning, God, because you said I am chosen. So I'm not going to be a chameleon. I'm not going to blend in anymore, God. But I'm going to stand out. from among them. I'm going to stand out for you, God. I'm going to be transformed and renewed for your glory, God. Because you said I am chosen. So I must represent the brand. Meaning my conduct, my behavior, everything must align with you. You said you're taking me on a process wheel, God. Hey, this is a process, and I put it all in your hands. Because you're one validator, God. You validate and order my life. You call me your own. You said I must choose my battles, God. So the fights I use to entertain and expending energies, God, hallelujah, this morning, I won't go there anymore. I'm going to let you fight my battles because the battle belongs to you. Because you said I'm chosen. There's a name change that needs to happen. Change my name. Change my attitude so it can align with everything that you've called me to be. Because you've chosen me for such a time as this. Wow. That's it. Right there. All the things that we're used to doing. How we're restructuring and ordering our lives. About the beginning of the year, let this be a year that you have never experienced before because you dare to step out. You dare to accept the challenge as God reminds you of who you are. As you accept the challenge to be, He therefore separated and come out from among them. As you are strengthened and encouraged for this journey to know that, yes, I can change and be a hallelujah, can go from a Saul to a Paul. It doesn't matter what the world thinks about me, but who does God say that I am? Who does He say that I am? Because I'm walking in His newness of life. I dare to step out. I dare to grab a hold of His hand because He said that I am chosen. I am chosen. I am His own possession. I am His people and He's my God. He's my God, meaning that He's responsible for me. So God, this walk that I'm about to go on, this journey that I'm about to embark on, I don't know where it's going to lead to, but you do. And I trust you in the midst thereof. I trust it with my heart. I trust it with my life. I trust it with all that I am. Trust you, God. I trust you, God. I trust you, God. I trust you, God. I trust you, God. May God bless and keep you today. And may His face shine upon you. May He give you His peace and His shalom. And may He always abide with you. I give it all to you, God. I give it all to you. 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 I will never be moved by the devil. You hear me? Y'all don't know what just happened in my house. But I will never be moved and swayed by the devil. He will never take me off course. So even though you saw me in darkness a while ago, amen be to God, I will still press forward. And that's what the Lord is calling you to. Don't get distracted and lose focus in this time and in this season. If the Lord said, I'm changing your destiny, I'm changing your focus, you better remain resolute and focused. Don't let the enemy take you off track this year. People, God is calling you to level up differently this year. Give it all to him. My life, my heart belongs to you, God. Trust him like never before. Place it in his hands. I pray that this word today was a blessing unto you. Don't let this year be another ritual. I'm just going to do fasting, but nothing changes. Make this word make you uncomfortable to want to look in and reflect on what God is doing and where God is taking you. Father, this morning, I thank you for your love. I thank you, Lord God, for your abiding love towards us, oh God. I thank you for your faithfulness, oh God, unto us, that even in our moments of despair and doubt and trials, Lord, I pray, God, that you will shine your light and illuminate the dark places in our lives. I pray, God, that when we see the light, we move towards you, God. God, I pray, Almighty God, that we will trust you and grab a hold of your hand in this season. Lord God, we don't know what the next hour, the next minute, or nor the next second holds, but you do. And Lord, we're saying right now that we trust you. You have chosen and called us out and separated us out. And Father God, let us not be the chameleons and let us not try to fit in. But Lord God, let us come out from among them and be ye transformed and renewed for your glory. Lord God, I pray that this year, Lord God, we will see, oh God, the manifestation of that which that you have placed on our lives. I pray, Almighty God, that birthing will come forth because we dare, oh God, to trust you and believe in you and to lean upon your ever word, your everlasting word. Oh God, Father God, we don't know what we are doing, but you do, God. And so, God, as you lead and direct our path, Father, let us continue to, oh God, follow you in every step that we take. Oh God, I pray for those right now that are in despair and are wounded and sad this morning because they've been afflicted on every side. Lord God Almighty, I pray, Lord God, that when they look to you, Lord God, how they will see their lives illuminated before them. Oh God, because you are the great I am. Hallelujah. You are the I am that I am. Hallelujah. So this morning, we thank you for what you are doing, God. I thank you that you are our God. You are Yahweh, the I am that I am. I thank you, oh God, that your presence, oh God, is ever present and ever near. So I pray this morning that as you draw close to us, oh Father, we will abide and remain in you. And Father God, we will be fruitful and we will multiply. We will advance, oh God. So this morning, we thank you. We thank you and we give you all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. And we say amen in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. This is Recharge Ministries, Pastors Carleen and Mark Hepburn this morning. And we're so happy and honored to be living right now in this time, where we're activating and accepting the call of God upon our lives for such a time as this. All of us are drawing closer. We're drawing closer. And this year, I think, gosh, I'm turning a special digit this year. And I'm like, God, whoo, there's no time to slacken up. There is no time to slack up and hold back, but it's time to go full speed ahead. Full speed ahead. So keep your eyes on the prize. God bless you, everybody. And I look forward to seeing you next week, if God's willing, because his mercy endureth. forever. God bless you.